And where were we a year ago as we come into what is our most popular episode every year of the Ron Flatter Racing Pod, the Hardcore Handicappers? You see me surrounded by them as if we were doing 4/9 of the Brady Bunch. But before we get to what they're going to say this year, let's review what they said last year about the eventual Kentucky Derby winner. Mage, coming from off the pace, as in the Florida Derby, is not how to win the Kentucky Derby. Mark asked connections about gate schooling. They said they hadn't when that was a concern. Ed said he was a flat-out toss. Johnny said definitely not a win play, probably not even an exotics. Mark thought this was going to be a nice horse down the road. He's got lots of potential. But just to show you that these guys know what they are doing, let me remind you what they also said. Ed and Mark already had drafted Mage in their Kentucky Derby Fantasy League. Johnny already had a futures ticket on him at 100-1. This is a demonstration. Hardcore handicappers might not be exactly right about their predictions, but sometimes they can still make money on them. And here are three guys who did just that last year with Mage, even though they didn't like Mage during Derby week. We start out with, how about the man who had that 100-1 futures ticket in Las Vegas? He runs DraftKings Sportsbook and DK Horse from Las Vegas. Here is Johnny Avello.
Good morning, fellas. I will tell you, I have no horse at 100-1 this year, unfortunately. There was nothing out there for me to grab this year that I thought was a great value. So glad to be with you again. And, hopefully we can cash some tickets and pick some winners this year and not throw horses out that are winners.
From here in the home office of racing, that is Louisville, Kentucky, a longtime TV analyst for Churchill Downs, whose handicapping is on display at such places as his Fair Odds columns that appear frequently and popularly at Horse Racing Nation. Here is Ed DeRosa, Mr. Fantasy Man on Mage last year.
Mark and I have a position this year as well, so we'll see how that goes. And my future wager that's live is actually on Epic Ride in the Preakness at 125-1. So if he doesn't get in, I hope they decide to go to the Preakness. But as for this Derby, I think it's the best we've seen in a long time. Can't wait to hear what you guys think of it.
A founder of Derby Wars and of Horse Racing Nation, his racing resume covers all manner of jobs in the sport. And the man who's on the vanguard of modern handicapping, himself a fantasy winner last year in his draft for the Kentucky Derby. Here is Mark Midland.
Great to be here, guys. And in fairness to all of us, keep in mind, the field was very different when we did the show, right? And I think I remember talking about Mage being a special horse or having done special things. But with Forte out and all those horses out, he became a much bigger use on Derby Day. And
full disclosure, I still didn't use him at all.
Okay.
All right. As Mark knows.
So I'll quit making fun of y'all, but I still would love to have been on the back end of some of that cash that you still had on Mage last year. So we will talk about, let's see now, the favorite again, owned by Mike Rapoli again, trade by Todd Pletcher again. Let's see if he can actually get in the race because Forte was out on Derby Day last year. We'll see about Fierceness, an Eclipse Award winner coming into the Kentucky Derby on Saturday. And I should tell you that as far as the weather is concerned for Saturday, as we are recording on Sunday morning, so if you're listening later, we know these things can change, maybe even the field, but 40% chance of showers and thunderstorms, but mostly sunny with the high near 75. So a dry day is odds on, but 2 to 3, I guess, would be the odds in that particular case. So we will get to all the horses in the Kentucky Derby field, and we will do this in bunches, numbers 1 through 8 in that order. So follow along on your PPs. But first, let me talk about the racing calendar's biggest day, which is also your chance to take a shot in a live money tournament where you could win more than $30,000 in cash. It's the Kentucky Derby Challenge from ExpressBet. It's happening Saturday. You can play right where you are right now. Use your phone or tablet or laptop with ExpressBet, or you can play right at Santa Anita. The buy-in is $3,000, $2,000 your bankroll. And not only do you keep what you win, but it's the scorekeeping device for the tournament. The other $1,000 is your entry fee, and every cent goes into the prize pool. So let's say there are 125 entries. If you finish in the top 5, you'll get at least $3,200 extra dollars in prize money. and the winner will get more than $32,000. If 175 people end up playing, first prize is more than $46,000. You see how this works. Oh, yeah. There'll be seats to win for the California Crown Betting Championship in September and the Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge in November and the National Horse Players Championship next winter in Las Vegas. So find out more. Go to expressbet.com/tournaments, and we'll have a link down below here on the podcast notes. If you somehow forget expressbet.com/tournaments, either way, you'll get the details. You can sign up right there to play on Saturday. It's the Kentucky Derby Challenge at expressbet.com/tournaments. Leave off that first E. Spell it this way, expressbet.com/tournaments. It's the Hardcore Handicappers podcast, three-fourths from Louisville and one-fourth from Las Vegas, the Ron Flatter Racing Pod. Let's go through the field now. You got your PPs ready to go? Okay, let's start out with the horse in the number one slot, and that would be Doorknock, trained by Danny Gargan, ridden by Luis Saez, coming off a fourth-place finish in the Bluegrass Stakes. Most recent win was in the Fountain of Youth. He is 20-1 on the morning line, and I'm also going to quote for you the best price showing Sunday morning in the futures markets in Las Vegas. Two books had reopened by the time we started recording. Coincidence would have it. Also 20-1 best price there. Johnny, since I'm talking about Las Vegas, let's start with you.
So, Ronnie, when you said we're recording and we're going to show this on Sunday morning, you mean the Sunday morning after the race, so we we should be right, spot on all
of you're right.
Okay. Anyway, Doorknock. Well, he was doing so well. And although the Bluegrass, it wasn't awful, he just didn't have it that day. He has handed Sierra Leone his only defeat, but that was a different year. That was different circumstances. The Fountain of Youth was his race, best race by far. There's nothing even close to it so far. And he did do it with a really small field. You know, Danny Gargan's been sending his horse in prior races, you know, prior to that Bluegrass. So, you know, the question is, do you send him here with all this? And what do you do out of this one hole? I don't know. There's really some tough decisions for Gargan and Saez. They're in a tough spot, unfortunately, due to that one post. Now, I know the one is better than it used to be, but it's still not ideal. So I guess there's a question, is that, and can the brothers win Derby in back-to-back years with Mage being his brother? I'm not sure about I wasn't even going to use this horse, even if he drew a good post. So certainly probably not a selection for me at this point.
Ed, what say you?
Yeah, that last point of Johnny is kind of what I was going to say. I didn't like the horse anyway, so I'm disappointed he drew the rail, not because I think it hurts his chances, but I think it kind of hurts his price. I wish he had a little more buzz because he's a toss for me. I really don't like that step backward in the Bluegrass, and I know Danny talked about, you know, it's a prep, they have the points, both of which are true. That was just too much of a step back, and I've heard some comparisons to Thunder Gulch. Guys, that was 29 years ago. I think we're beyond the Thunder Gulch era of, you know, what it means to prep for the Derby. So he's a toss for me.
Mark, you're up.
Yeah, he's in a tough spot. I think he's got to go from the rail. I think Luis Saez is going to give him the maximum security trip, you know, get out to the lead or attempt to. I think that's potentially going to, you know, set up more pace in this race, which makes it interesting as we look at the rest of the field. I think the problem with this horse, he just hasn't really improved that much this year. You know, I talked to Danny Gargan yesterday. I think just there's some little bit of, you know, we're just happy to be here feeling with his two horses. You know, if he were able to get clear, could he last a long way for something? Maybe, but I'm going to be against this horse. The rail doesn't help. And the other thing is the other horses know that he's going. So, you know, kind of, forces their hand as far as when we talk about some of the other speed. So this pace could heat up quite a bit.
I'm going to toss Doorknock myself. I know Mike Gillum, the winner of the NHC in Las Vegas, we had him on the podcast a couple of weeks ago. He's keying Doorknock, although we had that conversation before he drew the one. And if there was anything that was going to have me really tossing this horse, it was drawing the one. So be it for me. Number two is the second favorite in the early betting and on the morning line, and that is Sierra Leone, the exciting-looking closer who has won two in a row, the risen star in the slop, the bluegrass on the dry track. He has gait issues before the race. He certainly demonstrated that when he took 90 more seconds to load that it took him to run the race in the bluegrass. Chad Brown trains him. Chad looking for his first Derby win. He's 0-7. Tyler Gaffalione will be riding. He is 3-1, both on the morning line and best price in Las Vegas. Ed, we'll go with you first.
The gate issues are interesting because with this two-hole, they double load at Churchill. So he's going to be the second one in along with the 12. And so that'll be interesting to watch. This is the toughest call for me. Obviously, how can you not respect what we've seen on the track? 3-4 with the nose loss, electrifying late runs, especially in the bluegrass against the profile of the track. The end of the day for me is second choice. The speed ratings, performance figures, what have you, just aren't there to take him as the second choice. He's going to have to weave through a lot of traffic. And, you know, you can't use all the chalk. So is the second choice. I'm going to gamble and play against that he's able to get to the wire on time in this 20-horse field.
Mark?
I like Sierra Leone. He's my top choice. And, you know, kind of going back to last year, the one thing I did say about Mage is I thought he had done special things. I think Sierra Leone has done special things. The Risen Star, there wasn't a lot of pace. For a three-year-old debut, to have a closer take a no-pace race and circle the field, you don't see that. That's not a normal thing. That's, you know, and he's a nose away from being a perfect 4-4, which would be a completely different outlook in terms of probably the favorite instead of the second favorite. Just a lot of things, I think, in the favor of Sierra Leone. I get it. You've got to grit and bear it on the post and hope he works out a trip. But I'm going to go ahead and bet that there's going to be a pace that's going to set some things up. And, you know, the speed figures are good. And so, I mean, he's my top play. Not by a ton. I'm going to use, you know, several others with him. But I think he's got a great chance to win the race if the pace is honest and he's got to get by Fierceness. That's the main question.
Before we get to Johnny, let me follow up on that, Mark, because he closed against a slow pace in the Risen Star, but it was sloppy. Does that convince you then he's not pace dependent?
I don't think the slop had really anything to do with it in terms of, you know, pretty much any of the field in the Risen Star. The other thing too, yeah, I'm glad you said that, the Risen Star has been the key prep race of the winner, right? And so Catching Freedom ran third, came back and won the Louisiana Derby. Honor Marie was fourth, came back, ran second, and or fifth, I think. And then Resilience was fourth and came back and won the Wood. So the Risen Star has been a key race. He won an awful layoff with no pace. And, you know, so I think this is a real contender. And I mean, I wouldn't toss him.
Johnny?
Yeah, he hasn't done anything wrong so far, unless you want to consider the Remsen where he, you know, closed by 12 lengths and finished lost by a nose. And he does, his figs continue to improve. When I say figs, his rag numbers are moving up. He looks like he's still moving up at a great pace slowly. So his next race should be better. Same with the thoroughgraphs. You know, he deep closer, he needs the quick pace. And I don't know who wants to lead in this race, because whoever does, most likely, if it's not the chalk, is going to go out and burn themselves out and have no shot here. So there's just not much I can say negative about this horse, except his price is going to be too low. One beef I do have with the odds makers at the track is that if Sierra Leone is 3-1 before the draw and he draws the two, then he can't be 3-1 any longer. He's got to be 7-2 or 4-1. So make him a price that he, you know, a square price, I should say. And they did the same with Fierceness out of the 17. But anyway, neither Brown or Tyler Gaffalione have won this race. So, you know, a couple of guys that probably deserve to win it. But hey, he's going to, I think it's the two hole. He could get squeezed. He's going to be back. He's going to put himself in a position to do that closing again. So, May the racing luck be with him. I'm also going to use him. He's not my top choice.
And likewise, Johnny, I'm going to use him. Not my top choice. I'm a little worried about traffic. Although, look, you know, it's not like they're going down a narrow corridor, so there's going to be room. But I am at least a little worried about that. Just a little. All right. I'm always worried about traffic, especially if I'm driving on the freeways here. Number three, Mystic Dan, trained by Kenny McPeak, ridden by Brian Hernandez Jr. He was third in the Arkansas Derby. If it rains, yeah, you look at Sierra Leone, certainly for what he did in the Risen Star, but you also look at Mystic Dan for what he did in winning the Southwest Stakes, and that's his one stakes win on his record. 20-1 on the morning line, 30-1 best price in Las Vegas on Sunday morning. And Mark, you get to go first with Mystic Dan.
I think he's a nice horse for me. This is a horse that's going to finish, you know, in the top half of the field. He's going to finish sixth, seventh, fifth, something like that. The one thing that I'm kind of scoring him on is the Southwest. Now, in the slop at Oakland on February 3rd, the rail was very good. And so a lot of horses won on the rail, came back, didn't win. A lot of horses that weren't on the rail came back and won. So I'm kind of looking at that speed figure of the Southwest and knocking that down a few points. He did run third to Muth in the Arkansas Derby, but he also got beat by Just Steel by over four lengths. So for me, there's some nice things. Some horses I'd love to own, but I don't see it impacting the Derby at all.
Okay, Johnny.
His Southwest Stakes win was impressive, and his Arkansas Derby, the third, wasn't really that far off from the Southwest, although on paper it does look it, but those speed figures were real close. The one race that really stands out is the 5.5 furlong sprint at Churchill in last November, where he just annihilated the field and posted a 96 buyer. Of course, his next race after that, he goes off the favorite at Churchill at a mile distance and finishes fifth by eight lengths. To me, his pedigree, Golden Sense, says that he's a sprinter or a mile max. I just think the distance is just too far. He will not be used by me.
Yeah, that's a concern too. That's one of my concerns too, Johnny. What about you, Ed?
Yeah, the distance ancillary to the Southwest, which looks great, eight length win, but man, gosh, Liberal Arts was third. He's really disappointed since then. It was nine lengths back to fourth. So really questionable about the class of his marquee win. He's not a total toss for me like Doorknock, but he's on that final tier of I'm only using him with my strongest opinions.
Okay, I think I'm with all of you on this one. I mean, you know, distance questions, and at some point you got to throw somebody out. And I think just on merit, you do that with Mystic Dan. Number four, Catching Freedom, one of three in here for Brad Cox. Flavian Pratt will be riding. Here is a horse that's also a closer. We talk about the fact that Sierra Leone is so flashy doing so. Well, how about the fact that Catching Freedom went from 11th to first to win the Louisiana Derby at odds of 7-2? He is a 3-for-5, kind of like Fierceness. Good, bad, good, bad, at least in terms of the results. As you look at this one, a Constitution Baby, owned by the Albaugh family. We certainly have profiled them, Tom Padula doing so at Horse Racing Nation. 8-1 morning line, 11-1 in Las Vegas, Johnny.
This is a really good horse and another a deep closer. He was no match for Sierra Leone in back in that Risen Star in February on our sloppy track, but he has improved and he's not far from Sierra Leone as far as speed figures are concerned. He's also going to need that pace, just like Sierra Leone. So it's kind of similar. They're going to need a race that sets up for similar for both. He's got two races over to Churchill Surface with a win and a fourth, and certainly as one of the top trainers and jocks in the game here. Cox and Pratt both have won the Derby, both in unorthodox ways. And, you know, we could take a little time on that. Pratt needed maximum security to be disqualified, and Cox won a year later when Medina Spirit was disqualified and Mandaloon was declared the winner. So strange way to win a Derby for both, but they both do have that Derby win. This is a horse I will use because I see him very close to Sierra Leone, but at a better price.
Okay. I noticed you threw out 2020 because, you know, don't we all want to in life? But yeah, I get it. 2019, 2021, they had to wait until stewards made the decision. In one case, 22 minutes. In the other case, 9 months. Ed?
Johnny and I have a lot of agreement so far through a fifth of the field. I think his point about the similarities to Sierra Leone at, you know, 2-3 times the price is spot on. It's hard to not take the bigger price with these similar profiles. Now, Sierra Leone has bigger marquee wins before the last one that Catching Freedom finally got in the Louisiana Derby. But, I mean, in my mind, there's no reason to think that if either runs the race, they're both going to be right there based on what we saw last out. So he's on that second tier for me. I do like two others better. But, you know, at 8-1 morning line, yeah, but at 11-1, the price you quoted, mm-hmm. I'm definitely interested. You know, breaking that double digit $20 threshold to me changes things a little bit. So I'll be curious where he ranks ordinarily, whether he's the third or fourth or fifth choice. If he's the fifth choice, he moves up in my mind.
Yeah, I was a little surprised when Mike Battaglia, the morning line maker for more than 50 years on this race, put Catching Freedom ahead of Forever Young, who I think is going to catch a lot of popular money simply because he's from Japan and he's undefeated and there's some buzz, but we'll get to him later. Yes, Mark, what about you in terms of Catching Freedom?
Yeah, I agree with Johnny and Ed. Very similar horse to Sierra Leone. He's run really well. He's a great closer. I'm maybe not as persnickety on price as Ed. Come on, it's a Derby. Let's just hit the thing. Look at Sierra Leone.
In the exotics, I agree. It's not like
that's what I'm saying. It's a 20 horse field. Yeah. So if you can pull the exacta or trifecta, my point is use Sierra Leone and Catching Freedom together. Stop worrying about the trip. One of them will get a bad trip. One of them will get a good trip. You can't control it. You can't control the price. Bet a few more bucks on Catching Freedom if he's a better price, if that's what you want to do, or bet a few more bucks on Sierra Leone to make up for him being a lesser price. But I think one of them will get through. They're both very much win contenders. And the interesting thing, Ron, you know, we did this Kentucky Derby AI matching tool where we looked at all the past Derby winners, the horses from this year. It's a free tool. Anyone can use it. But when you look at the map we did, Catching Freedom and Sierra Leone are almost identical. So we've done AI matching on 18 different factors. And after all that, they come out almost identical to each other. So I do think they are very similar in running style, speed figures, the way they've come up to the race, number of races, all those good things. So I would use both.
Yeah, I'm a little reluctant to use both. And if I had to choose between one or the other, I'd be going with Sierra Leone. So I'm on the fence right now about Catching Freedom. I may just have to hit rewind and listen to what you guys said again so I can get off the fence. Number five, Catalytic for Safi Joseph Jr. Safi was not able to run in the Derby last year because two of his horses who died at the end of their races inexplicably, and even to this day inexplicably, he was actually suspended from Churchill Downs for a month and he was unable to run in the Derby. So this is his chance to try to get back in. Jose Ortiz will ride this long shot, who finished second in the Florida Derby. He was a mere 13 and a half lengths behind the winner, Fierceness. Let's see now. Catalytic, 30-1 on the morning line. But if you want a price, how about 80-1 in Las Vegas, Ed?
How about it? You know, I was pretty dismissive of this horse immediately after the Florida Derby, beaten 13. I actually like his ragazin pattern, not from a standpoint of, oh, he can improve and enough to win this race, but you know, with nothing to lose, if they ride the race to cash a check, I'm gonna sprinkle them a little underneath at a gigantic number. I think there's a chance just because of the connections. I mean, he's not the least likely winner, but I do think he might end up being the longest shot on the board, assuming number 22 doesn't draw in. And given that, it could be a it was a battle of midway situation when you had the chalk trifecta. And if this horse can get fourth, you can still really blow up the super. So he's sort of a, I don't want to say a strong key, but I can't be completely dismissive of a colt who's improved each time. And, you know, that last race, if he improves again, he can be fourth or third at a huge, huge number.
Mark?
Ed, I think you're talking about Instilled Regard was fourth at
88. Oh, that's it. Thank you.
Behind the truck trifecta, which paid $19,000 for the
season. Yeah, unbelievable.
Justify, Good Magic, and Audible, right?
Yep.
That was great.
Yeah, the tribe probably paid what, $400, and then the super is $19,000.
Yeah, yeah. It was, and we ended up hitting that with a group superfecta with some friends. And it's funny, before prices posted, everybody was like, it's all favorites. It's not going to pay anything. And one guy in the text chat said, hold on, not so fast. And we were very surprised when it paid $19,000. You know, this horse is just young. He's developing. He's only had three starts. He's a little more forward than I would like in a race that I think is going to be dominated by pace and horses, you know, proven horses like the two we've talked about in the Sierra Leone and Catching Freedom coming off the pace. So I have a hard time seeing him do anything here.
Johnny?
I talk about lightly raced with the three starts. So a maiden special weight last October, an optional claimer in early March, and then he's going to run him back 3 weeks later in the Florida Derby. I mean, it's a lot to ask. But the horse certainly has talent, and he picks up Ortiz, the best rider he's had so far. No disregard to Le Peru, but I do think Jose Ortiz is one of the best in the world. Who doesn't have a Derby win, by the way? I think it's a lot to expect for him to hit the board. But to Ed's point, he is moving up on the sheets, and his next race shows that he's going to improve some. He's not finishing last in this race. If he's either might be in the middle of the pack, and he might be fourth. So I wouldn't fault anybody for using him in the bottom of the super.
I won't. He may be improving in terms of his numbers, but he won a maiden race, was second by 3/4, second by 13. He could have a bigger number here and be, 15th by 20. So
that's true.
Toss. And by the way, four jockeys in four races, not a good sign. Number six, Just Steel. He is the most experienced horse coming into this race. And why not? Because he's trained by Dwayne Lucas, who he runs his horses, as he told us on the podcast last week. Keith Asmussen, one of the least experienced in Kentucky Derbies. That would be Nada. He is, of course, the son of Steve, a new jockey on the scene. And we look at Just Steel coming into this off of a second place finish in the Arkansas Derby at odds of 32-1. But before that, he hadn't won since a stakes race at Churchill Downs. Okay, a sprint back in the fall, but still a win over the track. So Just Steel, 20-1 on the morning line, 32-1 in Las Vegas, Mark.
This is a long shot that I'm definitely interested in. And I would say for the field, he's one of the horses I'm most curious about of what he can do. I think he's just kind of had, he's always right there. We're talking about the Southwest. I feel like Mystic Dan caught a track bias and a good rail. He ran second, but far back against Timberlake and the Rebel. He was parked five wide on the first turn, five wide, coming for home. But then he ran a really good second to Muth in the Arkansas Derby. So I feel like he's just kind of been knocking on the door. This is a horse I definitely want to use in my trifectas. Definitely want to use in my superfectas. I probably stop there. I don't really know that I'm going to use them in the exacta, but maybe in, I guess, with a few of my strongest opinions. But he's going the right way. Curious what everybody else thinks about him. Lucas, he trains his horses, or he runs his horses, and they have a habit of, as three-year-olds do, getting better and starting stringing races together. So it wouldn't shock me for him to improve again.
Yeah, Johnny, as much as Ed runs his horses, it's sort of like the way Leo Mazzoni with the old Atlanta Braves pitching coach used to run his pitchers out there all the time. So I don't know. Is Wayne the Leo Mazzoni a horse racer, or Mazzoni was he the Lucas of baseball? Whatever the case. Johnny, long-winded introduction to you.
Lucas, still in the game at 88 years old. You know what that means? That there's still hope for me. So glad to see he's still going. Lucas's horses, and it's Lucas, like you said, Ronnie, he runs them. This one's 11 starts, the most of any horse in the field. His last in the Arkansas Derby, very good race, but I'm not sure he's got another race like that, at least at this particular time. I couldn't fault anybody for playing him in tries and supers and using him underneath. But what I notice about him is when he runs a good number, he backs off. He's done that a few times during this stretch of 11. And this last number he ran was exceptional. So, you know, if I'm going to follow the pattern, it looks like he's going to drop off from that number. But, you know, if you think he's going to move forward, that race would put him in the mix and, you know, supers and tries. He's not one I'm looking at, though. But, you know, maybe I can be convinced by Mark after listening to him.
All right. Can you be convinced by Ed?
I think it's a fair price. You know, if ends up Lucas takes some money or, you know, whatever else around him, and he's shorter on the win end, that's not a great price. But I think we're getting maybe a little bit of a premium, guys, because the winner of the Arkansas Derby move, pointing to the Preakness, well, there's no chatter about him. We're not talking about the winner of the race he's coming out of. And I think Stronghold might have a similar vibe too, because you're not getting this buzz around the preps that usually you get when Baffert's participating in the Derby. So for that reason, maybe that's worth a point or two on the odds. But he got a really fast sheet number last out. But as Johnny said, he doesn't replicate it typically when he moves forward. So that's a negative. It's a really tough read for me. I like better than Mystic Dan, but you know, I'm not going to be excited if he's the one making a run at the eighth pole.
Yeah, I'm with you, Ed. A $500,000 colt by Justify means he looks more like a Lucas horse from the 20th century, but 25 years ago, charismatic, 1999, the last time Lucas won in his four Kentucky Derby victories. Number seven.
And I'm glad you mentioned Justify. If this horse were trained by Chad Brown, I'd be looking at Secretariat Futures on the Arlington Million card. I mean, what incredible turf breeding. So we'll see what the future holds.
Interesting. Okay. Mark that space for August at Colonial Downs, perhaps. Perhaps. You know, we'll see. All right. Let's go to Honor Marie. Honor Marie, yes, a colt. Number seven, a closer who was second in the Louisiana Derby, coming all the way back from 10th to finish within a length of catching Freedom. Trained by Whit Beckman, the longtime assistant to Todd Pletcher and Chad Brown. Ben Curtis, the native of Ireland, who decided to try his hand at Fairgrounds and wound up being the fourth leading rider there this winter. So he's going to stick around in the U.S. And lo and behold, he gets to stay on this Derby mount. 20-1 on the morning line, 30-1 for this horse who is named for the daughter of the Ribble family and also for the dam Dame Marie. So that's why we have Marie in the name of a colt. Johnny, it's yours.
Yeah, the horse looks okay. And, you know, he's got that closing style also. And maybe he won't be as far back as some of the other closers. But he's got Whiteworth who... he's got a wins at a very low percentage, and he's got Ben Curtis, who's on the biggest stage of his career. You know, he did move up in his numbers the last race, but that was a kind of a bit much bigger move than he has in his previous races. I don't know. He's not a horse that I'm eyeballing here. So I'll make it quick. I'm not using him.
Ed?
I'm eyeballing. What was our best price?
30-1.
Yeah, I might need to make a call to a friend in the 702. I think that's absolutely value on a colt who had an excuse in the Risen Star Stakes. The final workout into that race was totally botched. The exercise rider, I forget if he actually fell off or what, but it went as bad as a work going into your 3-year-old graded stakes debut could possibly go. So I draw a line through that race, and he still picked up horses late. It wasn't even that bad, but not indicative of what he's capable of, which I think we saw in the Louisiana Derby. He was a length off catching Freedom, who we all had some respect for. And I think this colt can improve again. So I'm a believer, and he's going to be a heavy use as, you know, maybe 20-1 on the tote. And like I said, I need to figure out how to get down at 30-1. That's a fantastic price.
Mark, we're looking at a colt here who has a win over the track, the mile and 16th Kentucky Jockey Club, to finish his 2-year-old season. What do you say about Honor Marie?
Yeah, I'm with Ed. This is a must use, a big use for me. Great price. One of the biggest prices of a horse. I think that's a real contender, especially for the Exacta. Has an outside chance to win. And Ed, you buried the lead. This is our Derby fantasy horse that we had Mage last year, and we have Honor Marie this year.
Oh, okay. Fantasy.
For whatever that's worth.
Yeah, no, well, it was worth a shekel or two last year, certainly. All right.
The horse is coming up to the Derby the right way, winning the jockey club as a two-year-old on this track. He's a closer. Again, I'm looking for pace scenario here. And, you know, I was skeptical about Ben Curtis riding here. You know, obviously you still have to have some level of skepticism first time in the Derby. But pulled some of our like advanced stats on him running in dirt routes and coming off the pace in dirt routes at the fairgrounds. And his stats are fantastic. I mean, really, you know, he's outrunning his odds. I forget the win percentage. I can pull it up, but he's done very well. He had a great winner down in Fairgrounds.
I'll tell you a couple things about this horse. He's little. That's one thing. But, you know, we've had little horses win. I mean, take a look at Mind That Bird. He's a closer. But I love, I mean, Ed, 30-1. I mean, come on. Schmooze my man Johnny here, you know, if you know what I'm saying. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. I mean, that you got to look at that. Whit Beckman was involved in the Super Saver campaign with Todd back when he won the Derby. So it's not like this guy doesn't know how to do that. And I will say this about Ben Curtis. He has a win at Royal Ascot. So he's not afraid of a big stage, you know. I mean, there was a queen involved there at that time. So with that in mind, yeah, I'm using Honor Marie. You better believe it. All right, let's get to number eight. We'll do a break here. We're going to break this in third. So
just real quick on Honor Marie, what price do y'all think he will be? Because I think there's a good chance he's one of these wise guy horses that ends up at more of like 15-1.
Yeah, when you asked that, Mark, that was the number I thought of right there.
I would have said the same, but the fact that he's 30 in Vegas, it's not like people, smart money, can't get down there. So maybe we'll get 20.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Number eight, Just a Touch. Brad Cox. We mentioned Brad once with Catching Freedom. We'll mention him later with Encino. We'll mention him now with Florent Giroux getting the ride here. Flo the Jock rode him to a second place finish last time out in the Bluegrass. Same colt, same combo, second in the Gotham. He's a maiden winner. Maiden winner was on Lasix and then has been off of it since. Two close calls. Coming back here in the Derby at 10-1 on the morning line. He is 15-1 in Las Vegas. Ed, I was impressed with how he looked moving forward in the Bluegrass. What about you?
Yeah, absolutely. And going into that race, trainer Brad Cox absolutely thought he had the winner, and Sierra Leone running as well as he did. I'm sure Brad disappointed not to win, but at least his confidence was rewarded because his colt ran great. And another one of those situations, I mean, just coming in with the right pattern. And last year with Mage, I talked about I was still on the Apollo curse. I was throwing out the, you know, the Justify had supposedly broken it. I'm off it now. I think Mage put it to bed forever. It's just not going to be a factor for me. So for that reason, you know, Just a Touch in the mix for me. And again, another one of those situations where you're going to get two, three times the price of Sierra Leone for a colt that was right there with him, made the lead, and then was ultimately collared and, you know, never was really a threat in the late stages. That was a super fast pace, though. I think in this one's fourth career start, he doesn't need to be as close, can be a little more professional. Certainly dangerous, and a B on the grid, is, as I like to say. He's definitely a player.
Mark?
Yeah, I would agree. Sort of a B here. I'm intrigued by this horse. I'm a little bit more biased to some of the closers, but this horse I have a lot of respect for. He's improved a lot, and you know, I definitely want to have him more so in second, you know, so he's sort of a B horse for me. But, you know, and then talking to, you know, I talked to Brad Cox last night after the post draw, he sort of lights up when he's talking about this horse. And I was just curious, you know, Ron, you've talked to him all week. Do you feel like this is his horse more than Catching Freedom and Encino?
I think it is. I think you have the same read I do. Whether, you know, you give him the truth serum and he would say that all over again. I think he might. I think he might. Especially talking to him after the Bluegrass, I felt like, okay, there's some real optimism here. It's convinced me, certainly.
Yeah, and he made a little quip, you know, in the bluegrass, the pace was hot. He said he quipped that, you know, Chad had a rabbit in there setting it up for Sierra Leone.
Kind of did. Yeah.
And, you know, but he did run very well against a hot pace. And so I think he's just a horse you've got to respect in here and use him.
Yeah, EP7 in Kieran speed points, which suggests, yeah, go forward. And against a hot pace, still worked out, Johnny.
I really like this horse, but, you know, he doesn't appear to have just enough base, what Ed just spoke about. But I said that about Justify, and look where that got me. So
me too. Well,
yeah, so we lost our shirt on Justify, and he goes on to win the Triple Crown. He gave Sierra Leone a battle in that bluegrass. I would think the plan is just to stay close for this lightly raced colt. He can surprise. He runs good every time from his first race and maiden special weight. The Gotham, the bluegrass, all solid races. His workouts are always good. He's just a good horse. And you know, is this his time? I don't know if this is time, but he will have his time at some point.
Yeah, I mean, like his daddy, you know, coming along a little late and growing into himself rather rapidly at age three. I do like this horse a lot, and might even key him. So we'll take a look as we get closer when I finally sort through and dot I's and cross T's. All right, Brad has one more in the race. We'll get to him in a moment, and we'll also get a snapshot of the Kentucky Oaks on Friday. In fact, we'll do that next. But first of all, I want to ask Mark and Ed, you know what I'm going to do here a couple times in this pod. It's plug time. Sell me something good.
Ed, go ahead.
Well, I know Mark loves talking screener, so I won't steal too much thunder there, but I would encourage everyone to go to you're on YouTube perhaps, but if you're listening to this on the RFRP, check out the YouTube page. We've got tons of great content about the Kentucky Derby Horse Center with Brian and Shipman. Did a great job breaking down various scenarios. Some videos with Shuddy talking about some of his super screener angles, and all that can be put into practice with our products available at picks.horseracingnation.com. So complete suite of content complementing the picks and analysis, and it's going to be a great week and hopefully lots of winners.
And if I may, let me throw in a little note for the super screener. Mike Shuddy is going to be on the pod, the Friday edition of the pod, to offer some of the thoughts he has in forming his Derby strategy. 2 decades of analysis results to help you build strong wagers and tickets every weekend, not just for these biggies, but if this is the time you come along, super screener for the Kentucky Oaks card Friday and the Kentucky Derby card on Saturday are available. There's also a Triple Crown package to include the Preakness and the Belmont Stakes at Saratoga. All of that at picks.horseracingnation.com. Click in the top left where it says Super Screener, and you'll find the Triple Crown package. Or just go there and find what you want to fit you right now. I mean, we're pretty flexible about these things, so you can find that. Mark, am I right here? Yeah. I mean, we could, you know, if you're looking for handicapping,
I'll tell you what you want. If you want to win on the Derby, you want to get the Kentucky Derby Super Screener. It's amazing, and you know, the thing is, with these fields have changed the last 2 years, and Rich Strike drew into the race what the first horse has ever drawn in as an AE into the Kentucky Derby. And we emailed out our customers to say this horse was the top long shot, include him in all the long shot wagers. And, you know, most of those wagers didn't necessarily have Rich Strike winning, but it was included generously in wagers. And a few of them, you know, a few people did hit it. And then the same thing when Forte came out of the race, we emailed everybody and actually said, take Mage and put him in Forte's spot in all the wagers. And that turned out to be really helpful for a lot of people. So it's been a fantastic tool. I wouldn't play the Derby without it.
Okay, you got the endorsement from a man who's there actually made a couple dollars using the super screener. So why don't you do it yourself? Find it right now. Go to picks.horseracingnation.com. That's picks, P-I-C-K-S, picks.horseracingnation.com. This is the Hardcore Handicappers edition of the Ron Flatter Racing Pod, previewing the Kentucky Derby. And before I get too far along here, I want to make sure I mention that we have Johnny Avello here. If you're watching on YouTube, and by the way, if you're listening on the pod, it'll be on YouTube as well and on X, so be looking for it there on the Horse Racing Nation pages. but you'll see in the background, Johnny has the green DraftKings Sportsbook sign, DK Horse. You want to give yourself a plug, Johnny?
Well, thank you. Yeah, this is a full year now we've been in existence with DK Horse. We've made some improvements. You can now use your user ID from the DraftKings app and use that on the downloaded app, DK Horse. Now, you still have to download that special app until we integrate into a shared wallet, which we hope will happen sometimes this summer. But we're making improvements. Things are going real well. We're having specials every day. We'll have specials on the Derby. There you go. Yep. And the specials on the Derby will be things like if your horse runs second or third, you get your money back up to $10. And we still have the deposit bonus of deposit $250 and get $250 if you play through it twice. So we're really happy with the progress we've made. And it's great to be with you guys to have handicapping, what you provide, and we provide the betting. So it kind of goes hand in hand.
Okay. Get the DK Horse app wherever you get apps, whether it's your Play Store or you do it through your Apple phone, all that good stuff. So DK Horse via DraftKings Sportsbook. Let's get back to the Kentucky Derby in a minute, but let's get to the Kentucky Oaks right now. $1.5 million on the line for these 14 three-year-old fillies, plus two also eligibles who will be racing Friday at Churchill Downs. This may be more competitive than the Derby if you look at the quality of this race. Tarifa was made the 7-2 morning line favorite. She is 4-5 for Brad Cox with Flavian Pratt riding, has won three in a row, including the Fairgrounds Oaks, which has been a bellwether for the Kentucky Oaks. So why don't we get a quick look at how our handicapping crew looks at this race. Mark, let's start with you.
Yeah, it's a great betting race and 14 fillies, and it's wide open to a certain degree. I'm really interested in a couple of the fillies that have only made one start this year for a couple different reasons. Just FYI, I think she had a fever and she missed one of the preps, but a good second in Ashland, looking for her to improve. She's got to come out of post 13, so it's a little bit of a challenge. And then Torpedo Anna, the five, she won by four in the fantasy in her only prep, looking for her to move forward. And then my third horse is Power Squeeze that won the Gulfstream Park Oaks. So I'm going to be looking at, I think it's 5, 12, 13.
How do you play the Oaks, Ed?
Well, I do like the Gulfstream Park Oaks, but I like the runner-up, Ways and Means. She's going to be a strong single for me. May even go so far as to say my best bet of the weekend. I think we're getting a premium because she didn't win that race. And I do have some concern that she's been odds on two in a row and finished second. And she is by practical joke. So I don't know that nine is her best. So I'm giving a lot of reasons of why would you bet this horse. But if she had won that Gulfstream Park Oaks, she'd be the favorite here. So she basically went from 3-1 to 9-2 in a competitive race. The workout, blistering fast last out. I'm in. I just think she's the best filly of what is a competitive group. But to me, that's where this is the type of race to take a stand because you know Just FYI can beat you. You know Leslie's Rose can beat you, but you're going to get the price to compensate. I think she wins far more often than the odds are going to dictate, and she's going to be a big play for me.
Yeah, wide post hasn't been a problem lately in the Kentucky Oaks, as we've seen in recent years.
No.
Johnny, what about you?
Really talented two-year-old fillies in here. Tarifa ended up with the best draw of all of them. And Leslie's Rose and Tarifa, Torpedo Anna. Just FYI, I like all the horses, but I'm a Ways and Means guy too. I think this might be a special horse with only three starts. And then she comes out with only one start this year out of the box, and it's an exceptional race like that. Yeah, I think this horse is an exceptional horse. So I'm with Ed on this one. That's my selection, and I'll use all those others around her.
Hey, listen, I'm greedy. I know even the favorite might be a good price in this race, but I'm sniffing for a price here, and I like Power Squeeze for Jorge Delgado and Daniel Centeno riding has won four in a row. The Gulfstream Park's Oaks most recently, and a couple stakes that were black type and listed before that. And so yeah, you say, all right, well, I'm black type enlisted. Those aren't graded stakes. Well, sometimes you can't help who you run against. I don't know. Maybe this is like Gonzaga in the Kentucky Oaks, but I'm going to go with power speeds. If I can get 12-1, Mark, what do you think?
Well, here's what I think. How many times has power squeeze wanted a mile or longer, 4 for 4? How many times has ways and means won past 6 furlongs? 0.
She's only run twice.
I don't understand everybody. There's a lot of people on ways and means, and I hear what you guys are saying, but it's not going to be 9-2, and this horse has never won a route.
She'll be 9-2.
She's never won a route.
Well, that doesn't mean she won't be 9-2. That's a reason she will be.
No, I know, but you're going to take 9-2 on a horse that's never won 2 turns?
I'm prepared to take 9-2 until my account says 0.
I think we got a side bet there with these two, Johnny.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've had two of my best bet days of the last year betting against this horse. It just keeps giving.
Okay.
So,
we'll find out.
You're in for a treat then.
Am I getting 12-1 on power squeeze?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I mean, okay. All right.
Yeah. I understand, you know, Ways and Means had some trouble and may have beaten Power Squeeze last time, but, you know, Power Squeeze wasn't even on the radar for the Kentucky Oaks in the top 10.
I don't even know that there was that much trouble in the Oaks. Yeah. Rider trouble, but I can't believe she lost, but she lost the spin away too. If she were 3-1 favorite, I'd have to look elsewhere knowing she could beat me, but I think 9-2 is fantastic.
All right. That's the look at the Kentucky Oaks, maybe a more contentious race already, even before it's been run, as we look ahead and get back to the Kentucky Derby after I tell you past performances heard on the Ron Flatter Racing Pod are provided by BrizNet, the only place where you can find Kieran's speed points, the easy way to map the pace in any race. Find out more for yourself at BrizNet.com. Back to the Kentucky Derby. Let's get to number 9, Encino, the last of the 3 Brad Cox horses we'll be talking about, and the last one who really was confirmed for the Derby, only after a workout during the weekend did Brad say, yep, we're going Derby, and we're going with last year's champion, Eclipse Award-winning apprentice jockey, Axel Concepcion, who just last weekend won his first graded stakes race, doing so in a turf race at Keeneland. And in fact, for Brad Cox, whose son is Concepcion's agent. So we're looking at a horse here who was won 3 in a row, won the Lexington Stakes just a few weeks ago at Keeneland on April 13th. 20-1 morning line, 27-1 in Las Vegas. Ed, we'll go with you.
I don't understand the buzz here. I mean, certainly a good horse. I understand why people might think that. I just think this is a tall task, and I do not like the never prep past a mile in the 16th. That's one angle I'm still holding on to when it comes to handicapping the Derby. You mentioned Charismatic earlier, Ron. He actually had run at a mile and an eighth before he won the Lexington at a mile and a 16th. He had been in the Santa Anita Derby for coach. So that's a little different. And again, that was a long time ago too. So just based on what he's done to date, clearly there's talent there, but from a Derby perspective, the 8.5 to 10 is a bridge too far for me, so I'm out.
Johnny?
He might be the horse that's shown the most improvement over a minimal amount of starts, and quite impressive from the synthetic to the dirt in the Lexington. The problem I see, he had 1 month between the Battaglia and the Lexington and a couple of weeks between the Lexington and the Derby. I like his pattern of improvement on the sheets. I was actually going to go play him yesterday. He was 50-1 in the future book. And by the time I got down there, they closed it at 3:45. So I didn't get a chance to play him at 50-1. Not that I think he's going to win. I just thought it was great value at 50-1. I kind of see him as maybe not. He's a horse that I would play in the future at 50, but I'm not going to play him at 20.
Okay. Mark?
Yeah, I'm with the guys. I mean, this is kind of an outside horse looking in. He's a nice horse, but it's hard to see him impact anything here. Now, it is interesting, too, you know, with Brad Cox having 3 and Catching Freedom being a deep closer, If the pace, you know, if he sends Encino or just a touch a little more to heat up the pace a little more, that's a negative for Fierceness and a positive for Catching Freedom. So I wouldn't be surprised if he does something with one of these two. And the fact that, you know, as Ed said, or you guys said, Axel is his son's the agent. So, you know, this is a long shot. They could send him to heat the pace up, sit just a touch a few links off, and you've got Catching Freedom way in the back. I think there's a lot of possibilities, but, you know, they were also hesitant to even run and finally declare this horse for the race. So I think that kind of tells you all you need to know.
That's from your lips to God's ears, Mark, and the fact that Ed, the distance preparation, look, it all conspires to have me betting against Encino, but I do like the idea that he could be in there to, you know, almost like he's setting it up for the Peloton, setting it up for the yellow shirt in the Tour de France. Two Japan horses drew next to each other, and we're going to talk about them now as we get to number 10. T.O. Password used the Japan road to the Derby to come into the race via a victory in the Fukuryu Stakes. Daisuke Takayanagi is the trainer. Kazushi Kimura, who you know at Santa Anita, you know at Woodbine, he's the rider, also a former apprentice jockey, the Eclipse Award winner, as is Axel Concepcion, as was Tyler Gaffalione. 30-1 morning line, 150-1 in Las Vegas for a horse who is all of 2 for 2, Johnny.
What could I possibly know about this horse? He's 2 for 2 at two different Japanese tracks.
There's video.
He's breeding his out of horses I've never heard of. I've never heard a trainer, Isaku Takayang Aji, whatever you said, Ron. I do know the jockey, Kimura. I know he's been riding about 5 years, and he did win that Canada's Outstanding Apprentice Award in 2018. But, you know, when I look at this horse on the past performances, it doesn't show much. I know he likes to go to the front, and that's how he's run his couple of races. And there's a bunch of horses here that like to go to the front. So I wasn't even expecting him to run in this race, and now that he is, I'm expecting to throw him out.
Okay. Mark, yeah, go to the front. God, do I hear summer is tomorrow all over again, Mark?
You know, it's hard to say. Like John said, we don't really know much about this horse. We know his chances to be up front. So, you know, there's a chance that they go like summer is tomorrow, that they you know, they commit and they go hard, and that influences the pace. Whether that really happens or not, you know, the American dirt races are just so much faster earlier than dirt racing overseas. So, you know, it just remains to be seen. But, you know, Kimura knows how to ride here. He knows what it's going to take. And this is a horse as a potential pace player. If he goes out hard, you know, to try to stay with Dornock, if Dornock goes out hard from the rail, you know, that's going to both influence the pace, and it's going to, you know, just get more horses out on the lead, which is going to put the outside horses even wider.
Ed?
I'd love to book 150-1. That sounds pretty sweet for the bookmakers. Just impossible to like here. And I've kind of pooped on this horse for weeks now, so I'll say one kind thing. He is the only one to carry 126 so far and win. So he has toted the classic weight, but that doesn't matter. He's hopeless. My comment to Scott Shapiro, who's my plug on some head-to-head wagers, is if T.O. Password is involved in any, I'll take the opposite for the maths. Don't even tell me what the number is.
Well, I'll tell you where I would take T.O. Password. It's with the next horse. And that's Forever Young, the other one from Japan who won the UAE Derby. May I get on my annual soapbox about the UAE Derby? That race should not be a major Kentucky Derby prep, period. Period. 0-for-19 with no horse finishing better than fifth. And I hear every year, this is the one. No, this one's different. No, the numbers are better. No, here's the number that's not better. It's 12,000 miles from Japan to Dubai to the U.S. It's 6,000 to go from Japan to the U.S. T.O. Password had the better path than Forever Young did, going through dirt that they say is the same in Dubai as it is in Kentucky. Really? Is it as humid in Dubai as it is in Kentucky? To hell with any UAE Derby horse. And the day a UAE Derby horse wins the Kentucky Derby, he will not have one penny of my money on him. Yoshido Yahagi's the trainer. Ryusei Sakai, first time riding at Churchill Downs, 10-1 morning line, 12-1 in Las Vegas. Mark. Your turn, Mark.
I'm going to defer to Ed. I'm going to let Ed go first on this one.
Okay.
Well, Ron and I clearly disagree. I do think this one's different, and I do think it's because of the numbers. Zarag is in devotee, and Mark and I get into this about some of the proprietary things HRN does. If you're going to believe in the tool, you believe in the tool. Dance with who you brought to the dance. And this horse is fast enough to win the Kentucky Derby. The Saudi Derby and the UAE Derby both stack up favorably against the numbers we've seen here. I've seen some consternation about, just barely getting by Bookham Dano. Look, that's fast U.S. sprint speed. I see it as a positive that he was able to wear that one down, shipping to Saudi Arabia. And then the UAE Derby was a win over a Southern Hemisphere 3-year-old. So, gave some age to that one. So there's a lot of positives here, including that this colt clearly has talent based on the sheets figures earned in those races. I've been a big anti-UAE Derby. I would say up until this year, I would have said exactly what Ron said introducing this colt. But I do think he's different, and I do think 10-1 is a fair price to gamble on that opinion.
All right, Mark, you want to jump in now?
Yeah, I'm with you, Ron. This, this is not a track record for success. We don't have to know why, whether it's the shipping or the quality of the horses or the way the races are run out in the Middle East, but it hasn't worked. I hear that the Japanese horses are getting better. They are. And I hear what you're saying, Ed, about the speed figures. But the thing about the Derby is it's the how the Derby is run. And the Derby is run with 20 horses on tight turns. It's unique to any other race. So I'm less concerned with the final speed figure of some of these favorites because he's not going to get there. And so my issue with Forever Young is, he's wearing a hood and he doesn't like kickback. One of my buddies put it well, like, what kind of low, weak energy is that? Like, the horse doesn't want kickback and he's this and that. That is not a recipe for winning the Derby. You know what that is? That's a recipe for what I call the Arazi trip, which is we have a horse that doesn't like kickbacks. So we're going to ride him 4 or 5 wide around the track. And then when it comes into the lane, the horse has no kick because he's run another 100 feet versus the rest of the field. If they want no kickback, he's going to be wide. He's going to have problems. He's going to have a wall of dirt. There's just so many things that can go wrong here. And, I can't use them. And I will say one thing I do want to say, Ed, you said it earlier, a great point about wagering is only with your strongest opinions. So I'm with Ron. I'm not going to put a penny on this horse to win, but with my strongest opinions, I'm not going to be stubborn enough. If like he ran second and Sierra Leone wins and Honor Marie runs third, I want to pick up the try once or twice. So I will use him only in that case, but I don't see it at all. So I'm going to do that very sparingly.
I'm waiting for Circa to put up the yes, no on this horse, and I don't care what I have to lay. Johnny?
5 starts, 5 wins, but horses like him and horses running their last prep in Dubai just haven't done well at Churchill Downs. But his numbers to me shows that he belongs here. I hear about the kickback. Well, they better fix that problem or they better go to the front. And they're not going to go to the front. That's not his style. This will be the first start in the Derby for both the jock and the trainer. But this trainer has shown success here with a couple of BC wins. I'm kind of with Ed on this one. I'm a sheep guy. And I look at when a horse shows a pair of numbers that are as good as any other horse in the race, to me, he's going to move up. And those numbers are shown not only on the rags, but on the thoroughgraphs too. So I hear what you guys are saying. You're looking at past success, but I'm not looking at past success. This Derby field is not that strong, and there's no reason why this horse can't win this race.
Okay. I have a big bet on this horse, by the way, a big bet. Frank Angst from Blood Horse and I made this bet. If Forever Young finishes in the money, he wins and I lose. The race is action, so he's got to get in the gate. It's a beer. It's a beer. But I want it to be a quality premium beer if it ends up that I win. All right, let's get back to the domestic horses, and we'll get to one who's got the lone equipment change in this race, and that is number 12, Track Phantom. He is trained by Steve Asmussen, who, of course, has been so tantalizingly close to getting his first Kentucky Derby win. Best trainer without a Derby win? Yeah, that would be Steve Asmussen. You have Joel Rosario, who certainly has known his way to get into the winner's circle at the Kentucky Derby. He'll be riding. Add blinkers for this horse who likes to front run. He did just that in finishing first in the LeCompte, did fade to second in the Risen Star, faded to fourth in the Louisiana Derby. Do you see a pattern here? I do. 20-1 morning line, 30-1 in Las Vegas, Ed.
I don't want anything to do with this one. I just don't see his path to victory. 2-1 favorite in Louisiana Derby and had definitely had no hope past the 16th pole. As the distances have gotten longer, he's gotten shorter, so to speak. I don't even think he can hang on for fourth. You run through all the scenarios in your head and none of them have him running well enough, throwing the equipment change. Sort of a last gasp, maybe a total toss for me.
Okay, Johnny.
And when you look at the last, the thought comes to mind: how far can he go? Can he go a mile? Is he a mile and 16th? A mile and an eighth seems fine, but then a mile and 316 seems to be a little far. He's going out. It's the only style that he's shown so far, and I know the horse tries and appears to like the Churchill down surface, but I just think a pretty significant move is required here for him. The first time blinkers might help. And Asmussen still looking for his first Derby win. That's unbelievable that he hasn't got one here. I don't see it. I mean, I don't know how he goes to the front, competes with all the other front runners and then still holds on.
Mark.
Yeah, I agree with the guys. He doesn't fit here. The blinkers on is a sort of a last ditch effort, but I did want to mention that to me, probably this horse and TO Password, I think, are just really key to the race. If we assume that Dornock is going, and let's say he goes as fast as he did in the Bluegrass, just a touch is fast enough to sit off a Dornock right there. And if those two do not go and press hard, then Fierceness can sit three wide. And it's a beautiful trip for Just a Touch and Fierceness. And I think we know what that means. If TO Password and Track Phantom go with Dornock and they're three abreast, Just a Touch maybe they're four abreast, I think Fierceness is going to have a hard time. So I'm really curious as to how Rosario rides this race, of course, and also TO Password.
Yeah, if we could have in-game betting available to us, that could really come in handy when we see how this unfolds. But I'm with you. I mean, I just don't think this horse gets the mile and a quarter, and I think that was proven in the Louisiana Derby. So he's a toss for me. The last horse drawn into the field was, in terms of the pill pull, was West Saratoga, who was given post position number 13. Jesus Castagnon will be riding. Larry DeMeritt, delightful man, in his 70s. He won't say exactly how old. If you think about him and Dwayne Lucas, they're both old school in the sense that they run their horses a lot. West Saratoga, with 10 starts to his name already, finished second in the JR Stakes way back when the road to the Derby began in September. This horse won the Iroquois, so has a win over the track. Larry DeMeritt will be only the fourth Black trainer in the Kentucky Derby since the Great Depression. So he will be carrying that banner as well. And he does so proudly, he says, representing a race of people, representing a nation of people. And he always says, don't tell me good luck, say blessings. He just has a wonderful disposition about everything in life. Great guy to be around. Do you want to be around the horse? 50-1 morning line, 110-1 in Las Vegas, Johnny.
I'll keep it short. This horse seems too slow. He doesn't belong here. The only angle I could possibly see is three starts at Churchill, one win, one second. Look, they paid 11 grand for this horse, so they're certainly playing with house money, but this horse just doesn't belong in this race.
What about you, Mark?
Yeah, he just, he doesn't fit here. Could be a potential another pace player if they're looking for a way to sort of change tactics a little bit to take a shot. He doesn't fit, and he's a toss.
Ed?
Yeah, a great story, and hopefully that attracts some wagering dollars for whatever reason, but that there's just no number here that's mildly competitive. And then catalytic, you could maybe say the same thing, but at least lightly raced and improving. I think we very well know who West Saratoga is, and it's just not a horse who can compete for the super here.
The story makes me want to throw him into the super, but yeah, I think ultimately when the rubber meets the road, I've got to take a pass here. But Larry DeMerritt, I'll have a great time dealing with him. Already have. He'll be on the podcast Friday. The native of the Bahamas trying to get it done in the Kentucky Derby. Number 14 is Endlessly. Was he supposed to be in the Derby? Wasn't he going to be in the Derby? The Ammerman family wanted to go. Michael McCarthy, the trainer, did not. Finally, you know, money talks, and the owners walk into the Derby, if you will, with Umberto Rispoli coming in from California, the native of Italy, will be riding. Here's a horse who finished first in the Jeff Ruby Stakes. He's only run on turf. He's only run on synthetic. This will be his first time on the dirt. 30-1 morning line, 40-1 in Las Vegas. Mark?
Yeah, that's the indecision about the Derby is a big strike here. You know, you can't blame the owners for wanting to run. This horse has run very well against three-year-olds. He looks fantastic. He's winning races. But the trainer that's with him every day doesn't want to run, doesn't feel like he handles dirt. And ultimately, as handicappers, we know you kind of want to lean with the trainer's experience. So got to toss it for that reason and wait for him to come back on turf another day.
Yeah, this reminded me a bit of Ron Bauer, who also won the El Camino Real Derby and then went on to win the Preakness. That was the Michael McCarthy path that he wanted, and the owners decided that was a good way to go, and it worked out very well in that particular case. Ed?
Yeah, and he has a Preakness berth with that El Camino win. So who knows what happens to Pan Derby. He's fun to watch run. I mean, I thought that Jeff Ruby Stakes was electrifying off the turn. El Camino, he handled a group, I believe the runner-up ended up supplementing to the Triple Crown, hasn't done much since, but the races are visually impressive. The numbers have not come back gangbusters by any means, and then when you couple that with the trainer's thoughts on dirt, just makes it tough to like. I mean, you're getting a huge, huge number that maybe on talent alone you can stick around for fourth or something like that, but overall, really tough to like and not going to be on my tickets.
He is 5-6 for what that's worth. The loss was a eighth in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf at Santa Anita. Johnny, what about you?
You're right, Ronnie. He's a winner in 5-6. All races on grass are synthetic. And besides the surfaces as being an issue, the distance could also be an issue. This is the one that you're throwing at the bottom if you're looking to boost your super or your try. This is not one that I typically use, but this is the one I always go back and look at and say, how the hell did he get in there? So he's a little scary in those regards, but he's not, you know, handicapping wise, I have little interest.
Ditto, if I may use an old word. 15, domestic product for Chad Brown, the other Chad, if you will. Irad Ortiz will be up. This is the latest attempt for this four-time winner of the Eclipse Award to get his first win in the Kentucky Derby. He'll be on the podcast Friday, by the way, of the coming week. Here's a horse who finished first in the Tampa Bay Derby and has been training up these 8 weeks to the Kentucky Derby. So maybe a different path to get in. How do we feel about that? Well, let's see now. The morning line and the Las Vegas price are both 30-1. Ed?
No interest in this horse. I'm stunned that he's getting some buzz. I know he worked well with Sierra Leone. That's great. I feel like we've seen this movie before with Destin and War of Will, two horses who went on to run well in other Triple Crown races. But the layoff from Tampa Bay Derby, coupled with no prep beyond 8.5 furlongs, just does not work. I hope people continue to talk him up. He won't be anywhere on my tickets. I mean, it's weird to say at 30-1, he's an underlay. It's sort of what, you know, Mark said about the lower end of the odds. Just for me, I don't see the path. I don't like the preparation. And we'll see what Chad does from here, because maybe next time is the time, as it was with War of Will. when he won the Preakness. But for me in this spot, no thanks.
Johnny?
You know, I'm certainly impressed with all the connections of this horse, and I'm influenced by the workouts, and I like the fact he's put a couple of good races together. My only concern is that he has to move up quite considerably to be a win contender, but he has to move up moderately to catch a piece here. I do realize he beat Fierceness in the Holy Bull, but that was Fierceness' first start of the year, and Fierceness was actually given a better rag sheet number than Domestic Product was in that race. The one thing that's hard for me to believe when I look at the connections here and I look at Irad Ortiz is that Irad Ortiz has never finished in the money in seven starts in a Derby. Now, how does that happen? Because he's always given the best horses. He always has the best horses no matter where he goes. And he's, you know, I don't know what all his Derby starts have been so far. I remember one where he came out of the one hole and, you know, that was an impossible feat for him to accomplish. But I don't know. I'm uncertain if I will use this horse or not. To me, he's not one of those horses you just say he's a throwout. I don't see him as that. But he's got to go a long way though to be in the mix, and it could happen. I might possibly use him on some ticket.
Mark, before I get to you, I'll tell you, Irad Ortiz Jr., seven starts in the Kentucky Derby, only once on the favorite. That was with the Improbable in 2019, and that was the last click before he became the favorite. Mm-hmm. Finished fourth there. Otherwise, 30-1, 19-1, 27, 9, 10, and Cyclone Mischief last year, 29-1 when he caught that ride after Forte had scratched, and he wound up finishing last. So that's the Irad history. Mark?
Yeah, I think I agree with both of the guys in the sense that this is not a win candidate at all, as Ed said. And as Johnny said, this horse could get a piece. I think this is a viable long shot for third or fourth. It's one I want to use on my tickets. And I think more so because there's an unknown quantity here. The pace in the Tampa Bay Derby was so slow. The pace in the Holy Bull was slow. And he hasn't run another prep. So I think we just really haven't seen what he can do. And down the lane in the Tampa Bay Derby, when he had a quick sprint to the finish, he outsprinted that field. It wasn't a great field. But I don't want to be stubborn and toss this horse. And he's going to be a big price, 30-35-1. So for me, he's a use in third and fourth. And, Chad Brown this week, he seems to like him a little bit. Maybe he's just talking up his horse. He's talking about him being in the second flight and kind of making a first run, which I think is interesting. I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing. But for me, he's just an include in third and fourth.
To me, he's better than that. This is a horse they were high on, and I talked to Chad too this week. Everybody's talking to Chad. Chad's been very chatty this
he's
week.
He's in a good mood. He's
He has the Oaks winner.
There you go. According to him, that's right. So here we go again. But he did two things. One, this horse had two bumpy rides last two times out, and he still was second and first. And the other thing is they were high on this horse last summer, and they really felt like this was the spot for him and that he was going to need to grow into it. So I think he has. And so with that, I'm going to hop on the Chad wagon a little bit and go with the other Chad and see if I can get a price. But I like the idea that I can get a big price on Domestic Product. What do we think of Grand Mo the First? One of the last in. It took some attrition to do it. We're talking about a horse who has a maiden win and an allowance win, and they were both before we got to autumn last year. Finished a very distant third in the Florida Derby, but then didn't everyone finish distant something in the Florida Derby? It's Victor Barbosa Jr. who does the training. Emisail Jaramillo is going to be the rider. And 50-1 on the morning line, that's 5-0. 90-1 in Las Vegas. Johnny?
Well, he's consistently in the money with six starts, two wins, and four thirds, but he's had trouble in just about every race, whether it's off slow, he's hit the gate, he's bumped, he's four wide, he's got every excuse that, you know, horses can make. And those are in races with six horses. So what's going to happen in a race like this, you know, with a 20-horse field coming out of 16-hole? I just think the owners and trainers are, and of this horse are just happy to be here.
Okay, Mark.
Grandmo the 11th would be a better name for him. he's just overmatched in this field. He lost to Fierceness by 16 lengths, and I think if he'd been in the bluegrass, he might have lost by 25 lengths.
All right, Ed.
Impossible to endorse.
Simple as that. I'm with you all on that one. I think we've found ourselves some agreement here. Let's find ourselves with some opinion about the favorite. We haven't talked about Fierceness yet, so let's do that. I have a hunch that's going to be some fodder for a little bit of conversation coming up as well. A little later on, we'll hear the best ways to play the Derby from our panel. Have you ever pictured yourself in some of those big handicapping contests like the National Horse Players Championship, but you only remember to do so when it's too late? You know, when you see everyone's already in Las Vegas? Yeah, that's too late. But you're not too late now. I have a way for you to try to get into the NHC by playing this weekend in the Kentucky Derby Challenge from ExpressBet. This is a live money tournament where there are thousands of dollars in prizes on top of what you make with your bankroll. And there will be seats awarded for the California Crown Betting Championship this fall, the Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge this fall, and the NHC in Las Vegas next winter. And on top of all that, you could win more than $32,000 in cash if you win this weekend. Here's how it works. Go to expressbet.com/tournaments, or you can click the link we have down below. That's where you have the FAQ, and you can sign up for the Kentucky Derby Challenge on Saturday. Play right there on your handheld at ExpressBet, or show up with your friends and rivals at Santa Anita, and you can really play it live. $3,000 to get in, $2,000 for your bankroll, the other $1,000 for your entry fee, and every cent of that goes into the prize pool. Play your way into the biggest handicapping tournaments. It's the Kentucky Derby Challenge. It's Saturday. It's at expressbet.com/tournaments. As I always say, leave off the first E. It is spelled expressbet.com/tournaments. The hardcore handicappers moving into the home stretch as we look at Kentucky Derby number 150 on Saturday. Johnny Avello, Mark Midland, Ed DeRosa, and me. And let's get to the favorite, the Eclipse Award winner as the top juvenile two-year-old male of 2023. He is Fierceness. He won the Florida Derby by 13 and a half lengths. He won the Breeders' Cup Juvenile by more than six lengths. His maiden win was by more than 11, but sandwiched in between there in his even-numbered races, a very distant seventh in the Champagne after a bad start. And then in the Holy Bull, he got pinballed at the start and finished third there. So good, bad, good, bad, good. So what will he be this time? For Todd Pletcher, the two-time Derby winner, Johnny Velasquez, who's won 3, 5-2 on the morning line. No better than 2-1 right now in Las Vegas as we were recording on Sunday morning. Ed?
He's definitely the most likely winner. When it comes to favorite, though, what I think is interesting about him is he will be the win pool favorite. I would not be shocked if Sierra Leone is the favorite in the place in show pools, as people think that, at least he'll be closing and it's all or nothing for Fierceness. It's hard for me to disagree. So when we get to wagering, we'll talk a little bit more about that. But, you know, guys, we've all seen a lot of races. That Florida Derby was as good as a prep as I can remember. I mean, that was spine tingling to me. I thought it was just electrifying, the run he gave with all the, you know, questions surrounding what we saw. To me, Ron, more than the on again, off again, which may be slightly coincidental, it's the fact that when he has had two tough starts, he's been nowhere. And obviously in the Kentucky Derby, that's a concern. The comment for the Holy Bull says pinballed. That could happen anywhere in the Derby field. Mm-hmm. So the break is essential. I don't mind the outside-ish post. And I do love the fact that this jockey, for better or worse with the DQ on Medina Spirit, but the way he won on Authentic and Medina Spirit, at least under the line first with the latter, I expect to be the trip Fierceness gets if he's going to win this race. So those are the positives. 5-2 is absolutely my floor with this one. But if Honor Marie runs well and Fierceness does as well, that's an ideal scenario for me.
Johnny Velasquez may be the best front running rider going right now. I mean, he's shown that in the Kentucky Derby a few times too, Mark.
Absolutely.
What do you think, Mark?
Yeah, I mean, I think Ed makes some good points, and that I will cover him in my wagering. Like just like Ed said, if Honor Marie runs second with Fierceness, I want to have the exacta. Fierceness wins, Honor Marie runs third, I want to have the trifecta. So the way I would bet this race, the way I'm going to bet this race is, you know, take 10 or 20% of your bankroll and cover those Fierceness combinations that you just can't live without if he wins and your one of your favorite horses runs second or third. Then just toss this horse. There's nine ways that he can lose this race. He could break bad. He could get bumped. There could be too much pace. He could get carried wide. They try to rate him behind horses. He doesn't want to take dirt. The thing about his in and out races, if you go back and I kind of did this last night and looked at these five races, the two bad races, he's not really on the lead. The three wins, he's on the lead, or in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, he's second, but he's wide and he has clear daylight in front of him. So there's no dirt coming back to him. Okay, so in this race, he can't be on the lead. He shouldn't be. If he's on the lead, he wins. But there, you know, I'm just looking at like the time form pace projector. He's not even in the top four of fastest horses. And if Dornock has to go from the rail, and we're talking about, you know, TO password, we're talking about blinkers on Track Phantom, even Just a Touch might go out there. Where does it leave this horse? He's either going to be four wide or five wide, or he's going to be in the second flight taking dirt. And if we look at the past performances, he doesn't run well in that scenario. So
isn't that projector counting the races he wasn't on the lead though?
It's a mix of everything. It's mixing everything. And you know, but I mean, the Bluegrass was much faster. So, I mean, I rewatched the Florida Derby last night. It was a workout. He broke from post 8 of 9 and he cut over to the lead in front of horses. Let me read these names. Would you have known any of these names a month ago? Catalytic, Grandmo the First, and Lidom Bro were the three horses he beat to get to the lead in 24 seconds. I mean, that was a workout. So, like, to me, what I don't understand is it doesn't matter what number Fierceness runs. That was the Florida Derby. This race is not the Florida Derby. He will never get that trip. Most horses don't run in the Derby back to their figures from the previous races because there's 20 horses and all these things they have to deal with. So now I will caveat this to say, if he gets what I call the American Pharoah trip, if he can sit three wide right near the lead, that's going to be a good spot for him, and he'll probably win from that spot. But I'm counting on some of these other pace horses to go. I'm counting on the pace to be faster. It wasn't that fast American Pharoah's year. And I don't know that they want to send this horse that fast. Now, maybe that's their best chance, and maybe they just blow out the field in the first, half mile, and they're right up with all these long shots going 46, and they just roll their dice that way. But I just feel like there's so many ways this horse can lose. As a 5-2 or 2-1 favorite, you know, cover them with the horses that you like and then just toss them after that.
Let's see now. All the speed to the inside, I will note that, but you know, it's 17. That's kind of what you may be left with. And that's what Todd Pletcher said is a good thing. Johnny?
Yeah, I agree with the guys on a lot of things. The last race was great. He gets loose on the lead against an ordinary field. He blows him away. He may have beaten this field on Derby Day if he ran that same type of race again. But in his five races, he just shows that inconsistency to me every other race. And it's true, there's no better rider to have than Johnny V, who's won 3 Derbies and 25 starts. And with all success Mike Rapoli's had, he hasn't won the Derby, and this may be his best shot. I got to tell you guys, this is a horse that I'm not planning on winning. The price is just way short. I'm probably not using this horse anywhere. I mean, just because his price is so short. It's 17 posts. I don't see any trouble of him getting to the lead if he wants to get to the lead, because there's not a lot in front of him will prohibit him from getting the lead. But if he doesn't get the lead, he may be in trouble. And so I'm just, when I say I'm not using him, I probably will have to at somewhere in there, but he's not the horse I'm looking at as the win contender.
He's one of mine, but I, you know, I'm with you guys in terms of, you know, of course we want a better price. Why wouldn't we? I think he's the best horse, period. I mean, just look at these horses. He's the best horse, simple as that. I will say this. Post 17, it'll be said a lot. 0-44, according to the Kentucky Derby media guide, in terms of winning the race. Okay, well, there is that. You know, if 0-19 in the UAE Derby into the Kentucky Derby means something, what's 0-44 mean? Of course, he could have a scratch to the inside and he wouldn't be in 17 anymore, but we'll find out. I could see history being made, but I will include Fierceness among my top plays.
And Ron, we should probably Travis Stone had a great tweet on the stats. So the favorites that lost as a three-year-old in their campaign up to the Derby have been 1-17 since 1993. And that includes Street Sense, who barely lost a prep. And the 9 horses that were Derby favorites that won were undefeated, 26 out of 26 as three-year-olds.
Interesting. Holy Bull, 1-5 was Fierceness when he finished third, would fit that template. Number 18, Stronghold, won the Santa Anita Derby. If it weren't for him, California would have been without a Kentucky Derby horse for the first time in more than 70 years. Phil D'Amato in his first Kentucky Derby, ditto for Antonio Frazou. 2 in a row in terms of wins from the Sunland Park Derby as well as the Santa Anita Derby. 20-1 morning line, 30-1 in Las Vegas. When was the last time we said that about the Santa Anita Derby winner coming into the Kentucky Derby, Mark?
Yeah, that's been a long, long time. You know, I think this horse is one that you don't really want to toss. I mean, the post isn't great, but he's been raced lightly, you know, just a race in February, a race in April. So he should improve here. He's got a nice style of pressing the pace. His figures are decent. He's working well. So I think there's a lot of positives here. And this is a horse that you want to include. For me, he's a horse I'm going to use a little bit in second and more so in third. I don't know that I see him winning, but, you know, he's in that second tier. He's like a B horse for me.
Okay. Johnny?
He's either first or second in 6 short career starts, and he looks impressive off the PPs. If you just look at everything to the right, you look at everything to the left, maybe the buyer figures are not impressive, but, you know, how much will he move forward? He's been running against slightly weaker company in his 4 graded races, although he did run second against Nisos last year, but he lost by a ton. I do like that he stays rather close to the pace. He's got a win over the surface. He might be just a tad behind the main contenders, which means a shot somewhere maybe in the money. A couple of small knocks for me is that D'Amato and Frazou, both first time Derby in Derby land. But when I look at his sheet numbers, you know, he can move up and get a piece of this. So he is a horse that I will be using in the tries.
Ed?
Yeah, I'm pretty similar, I'd say. Kind of reminds me of Just Steel in that regard, other than he won his last prep. But it was solid. I mean, there's just not a ton of knocks here. Performance wise, the numbers are, you know, a little short, but he's by Ghost Zapper, which I actually like a lot for the classic distance. So maybe some improvement there. And it's a rare year. We have as many Italian jockeys as we do Frenchies in the race. So it's kind of interesting. Doesn't really mean much for betting, but I find it interesting. But yeah, he's, you know, he's in the mix. You know, if I'm right everywhere else, I wouldn't want him to beat me, but definitely no strong opinion on him being value on top, but in the mix with several others underneath.
Yeah, he beat a Baffert horse in the Santa Anita Derby, but he lost to Baffert horses in the Bob Hope and the Los Al Futurity. And California just ain't the colony it once was. So Stronghold, not on my tickets. Resilience. Now, New York has had a bit of a renaissance when you consider Triple Crown races overall and races that from New York feed Triple Crown success. Okay, maybe not in the Kentucky Derby, though. Resilience did win the Wood Memorial after finishing 4th to Sierra Leone, Track Phantom, and catching freedom in the slop of the risen star. Good comeback for him then at Aqueduct for Bill Mott. Junior Alvarado will be riding 20-1 and 30-1, just like Stronghold, 20-1 morning line, 30-1 in Las Vegas. Johnny?
Yeah, he comes off that Wood win, and that's his best race to date. He couldn't stay with Sierra Leone and the Risen Star, but that was an awful surface that day, and that was his first stake try after trying four times to break his maiden. He's another that will try to stay very close to the stalking position. I have a lot of respect for Billy Mott. Not only has he had a spectacular career, but a really good, solid couple of years. He's got one Derby win in 12 tries. That was Country House, but that's Billy Mott's the draw for me for this horse. The horse really improved the last race, and a little bit more improvement on that. He's also in the mix. I hate the post, of course, but he's a horse that will be used.
Ed?
You know, we talked about the UAE Derby, and certainly that record isn't sparkling. In the points era, the Wood Memorial is yet to produce a horse who's hit the board in the Kentucky Derby. I don't know why that is. I mean, it doesn't make sense. This is a prestigious race on the top circuit in America. But this particular Wood Memorial completely fell apart. The top two choices were total no-shows. There was an incident with a horse in the race as well. It's just really hard to trust. Well, came back a big number on Brisnet. I think this horse will be a little overbet because of that. The win, Mott certainly attracts some attention. You know, one of those, you know, you have to make some decisions along the way. And I certainly won't be shocked if this horse runs well, but just at the price and among the others I like, this is one I'm willing to sit out.
Yeah, top circuit in America, Ed, but no one wants to be there in the winter. You know what I'm saying? I mean, yeah. I love living there, but, you know, in terms of everybody's in Florida, that's the NIT compared to, you know, like NCAA regionals down at Gulfstream. That's how I look at it. Mark?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I'm probably more with Johnny that, you know, it's Bill Mott, and he's had a good run. I think this horse is coming up the right way. The Risen Star was a key race. He did win the Wood, and he did win it easily. So I'm kind of used this horse a little bit in third and fourth, probably more so because of Mott and because that was my plan before he drew the 19 post. And I would still, hate to lose that way. So I'm going to touch him in trifecta and superfecta, but that's about it.
Yeah, I'm an underneath player with resilience too. I don't just dismiss him based on my little snarky comment about not wanting to be racing in New York in the winter. I think this is actually a decent horse, but I don't know. He's not decent enough to win the race. The 19 Colts are followed by the one Gelding in post 20. Society Man, Danny Gargan's other horse, Frankie Dettori, picked up the ride here. It will be the second Derby for Frankie Dettori, who really wants to win one. Second place finisher in the Wood at 106-1. Yeah, the owners really want to be here. The owners really want to be here. Should he be? 50-1 morning line, 210-1 in Las Vegas. And by the way, one book doesn't even list him in Las Vegas. I won't say which one, but Elvis has left the building. Should be your clue if you do your research. Ed?
Well, he shouldn't be longer than TO Password. So for that reason, the 210 line, I guess, is value from that perspective. If I saw a head-to-head, I'd take him over Doorknock, his uncoupled stablemate. But I don't like him either to be in the mix. Just hard to like. I mean, I said why I wasn't really high on the Wood Memorial with resilience. So certainly the runner-up 2 1/4 lengths back fits that bill as well without the bona fides that resilience had, having been in the Risen Star. So, yeah, tough row to hoe from post 20.
Mark?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. The horse is improving a little bit, kind of jumped up. I mean, you know, Good Magic has been really good sire, as we saw with Mage last year. So, I mean, if he's 99-1, or I guess he's not going to be that high in the pari mutuels, but I could see, you know, maybe having him in fourth in the superfecta a couple times, just kind of goofing around, but that's about it.
Johnny?
Yeah, he saved his best race. You mentioned it at 100-to-1 odds, finishes second in the wood to resilience. I think the step up was too large and he'll regress. And when I say step up, the race from the maiden special weight up to the wood, I just think that that move was just too much. And I think that he's going to regress here. I think the decision to use the Tory is going to draw public money. So he's probably going to be shorter than he actually should be. But no, I don't like him here.
And I will add my, well, no, I won't add 2 cents to it, but I will chime in at least and agree wholeheartedly with society man being a toss. Let's get to the also eligibles. I will point out in the 11 years of the points here in the Kentucky Derby, twice the race has been undersubscribed. The other 9 times, there have been 4 also eligibles who found their way into the superfecta. Now, we know about 2 years ago from Rich Strike at 80-to-1 to win the race. Number 21, Epic Ride for trainer John Ennis. Adam Baskitsa will get the ride if he gets the ride. Third in the Bluegrass was a winner in the Leonida Stakes at Turfway Park. This is a horse who's been mostly on synthetic, made the dirt debut and finished third last out in the Bluegrass at odds of 51-to-1. He's 50-to-1 morning line, 100-to-1 in Las Vegas. Mark?
Yeah, I'd really like to see this horse run. We were kind of watching him run at Turfway this winter, and you know, he's done very little wrong. You know, 100% in the money, 2 wins, 2 seconds, great race in the Bluegrass, tracking a really hot pace. He was wide, and I'm really just curious to see how he fit, you know, how he could run if he gets in. So I'm hoping that he gets in. I do think he could present a little bit of problem from Fierceness. He's got some speed, and they may want to send if they're coming out of the outside post there. So that's another thing to consider. You know, can he really hang around for a lot? It's possible. I mean, he's kind of been a favorite of mine and a lot of people here in Kentucky because of the Turfway this winter. And so I'll use him a little bit in third and fourth, but he's not a contender for the win or exact or anything.
Johnny?
He's always forwardly placed. The Bluegrass was a pretty good race, and he deserved to be in that field because of his accomplishments leading up to that on synthetic. The post would be so tough, though, here to overcome. But if he does get in, I'll take another look at him because of what Mark said. I mean, he's run pretty well so far, and his last couple were good, and his dirt race was good. So certainly worth looking at if he does get in. The problem is that we probably won't have a field of 20 horses in this race because when is the cutoff, Ronnie? Is it Wednesday or Thursday?
Friday. And Friday at 9 Eastern.
Oh, it is Friday? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's usually something that happens in that last day and a half. So there's a good chance we won't have 20 horses in the field, and we may not have either one of these also eligibles in there either.
Okay. Ed?
If he gets in, he's either going to cost me a lot of money or make me a lot of money because I like him a lot at the price. I mean, one of those, like, I would be excited to play this horse at 40 or 50-to-1, even 30-to-1. He would be equal strength with Honor Marie for me in the various exotics. I just think it's a real separator if you can get him into the gimmick in any way, shape, or form. And the perfect example to me of a horse, you know, and it gets really expensive to use them all and even all the contenders, but this is the perfect example of a colt that if he finishes second to Sierra Leone, I can't lose. Like, I mean, Epic Ride is the type of horse, if he runs well, you have to have it with the logicals. Now, if he finishes second to Door Knock, I'm going to have to lose because Door Knock's not a horse I want to use at all. But the ones that make sense are going to be on my tickets with Epic Ride. I think he has a big chance to outrun his odds. Maybe he throws in, you know, maybe he's not good enough at 30 or 40-to-1, but that's the right price for me to find out.
I don't think he gets the distance. Simple as that. I don't think he gets the distance. I don't think he's as bad as, others who might not get the distance, but I that's my big question. So I'm, if he gets in, I'm not going to go there. Magatu only had 14 points when really about 40 was the cutoff to get into the field. But Jeff Engler and the owners, they decided, all right, hey, throw us in there. And, you know, if nobody else wants to go, we might. If he does go, he would be the most experienced horse in the race. It would be his 13th start, finished fifth in the Bluegrass. He's 1-for-12, won a maiden race on his third try on a synthetic track. That was at Gulfstream Park on the Tapeta there. Tried the turf early, tried the artificial, finished fifth in the Bluegrass. Joe Talamo gets the ride. There you go. Marty McGee got him something there to stand by. 50-1 morning line, 100-1 in Las Vegas. Johnny?
One win and 12 tries. Last his best, but still a very weak race. He doesn't like artificial, doesn't like turf, he doesn't like dirt. So what does he like? He doesn't belong.
The walk from the gap to the paddock. By the way, paddock, the new paddock looks great. Ed.
Yeah, I mean, no use whatsoever.
Mark.
Yeah, I was going to ask Ed, you did that. So TO password was what, 1,000-1 on your fair odds? What would this horse fair odds?
990.
990-1?
I mean, TO password is the least likely winner of this race I have ever seen in my 22 years covering it.
All right. I would say this is up there. I would say this horse is
five. I would take Magatu for the max in a head-to-head with TO password.
Well, that's different because the TO password goes out, you know, he could
start. Right, no, but, fair. I mean, even if you told me Joe Talamo is dead send if he gets into this race, I would still take him over TO password.
Well, and this is just one, just real quick, you know, we always talk about the public money in the Derby and the Triple Crown races. If this horse gets in, I mean, I think he should be 1,000-1 or higher. He might be
80-1.
He might be 80-1. He might be 50-1. He might be 55-1 with the way we see the public. I think what Giacomo and Rich Strike have taught people is, hey, any horse can win the Derby, no matter how much of a long shot. And it would be really fun to see what the odds are on a horse like this.
Only on the Ron Flatter Racing Pod would you get this much talk about Mugatu. I'm telling you right now, we are thorough. We're going to come back. We're going to get the best plays from our panel before we send them on their way, before we send Mark and Ed on their way. Mark, sell me something good again.
Well, we talked about the Kentucky Derby Super Screener and all the great products at picks.horseracingnation.com. One of my personal favorite is Sire Moves Report, and it's in our Pro Report package. If a horse is switching from turf to dirt to synthetic, or going from a short race to a route race, it breaks out you know what that means for the pedigree and what the outlook is for the horse, and it's the kind of stuff you just really can't find anywhere. That and then the first time power report is amazing. You're going to get ratings 1 to 5 stars on every first time starter, and first time starters are just, you know, the bane of the existence for a lot of horse players. They haven't run. There's no speed figure. They don't know what to do with them, rightly so. And the first-time power ratings give each horse a 1 through 5 stars, but it's looking at, the algorithm looks at the strength of the field and how well the horse matches up. And Ed, what are 5 stars are winning about, what, 22% these days?
Yeah, and including one at 42-1 at Keeneland.
Wow. So those are two of my favorites.
And make them yours, too. In fact, when you go to picks.horseracingnation.com, why don't you become familiar with the Pro Reports and get a membership package and actually just go around on there and see what fits for you. And if you get the big package, I mean, you know, Mark, that's the one that has everything, right?
Yeah.
There you go. Hey.
All you can eat.
All you can eat. Yeah, I was just going to say, it's like the Las Vegas buffet, except you don't end up having problems like an hour later, if you know what I'm saying.
And we're still open.
That's right. And we're still open. Go to picks.horseracingnation.com. You'll see a lot of tools there. Why not sample that for yourself? Picks, P-I-C-K-S, picks.horseracingnation.com. Before we get to our best plays for the Kentucky Derby, let me remind you the regular episodes of the Ron Flatter Racing Pod are heard every Friday. It has been there like clockwork every week for 6.5 years. So if you're only coming along now, hope you come along for the other 51 weeks of the year. The episode from the past week, still up, has D. Wayne Lucas, Pat 40 from Sports Illustrated, and Paddock Prince handicapper David Levitch. Friday's episode, our cast of thousands among Derby connections, including West Saratoga's trainer Larry Demerit, four-time Eclipse Award-winning jockey Irad Ortiz Jr., and all the connections for Derby favorite Fierceness, including jockey Johnny Velasquez, trainer Todd Pletcher, owner Mike Rapoli, and we will also have super screener creator himself, Mike Shutty. So whether it is Apple, Firefox, iHeart, or Spotify, or just finding your way at horseracingnation.com to find the episodes, check out our regular Friday edition of the RFRP. Final thoughts, best way to play the Derby. Let's start with Ed DeRosa.
For me, the three keys, so to speak, are Honor Marie, Forever Young, and Fierceness. It's the most likely winner and best horse in the race at his best. I can't deny. So basically, I'm going to play it with two of the three have to run well. If it's Honor Marie and Forever Young, that lets me use some of the more logicals like Sierra Leone. And in the tickets where it's Fierceness and one of the other two, then some of the favorites I'm less likely to use. And with Fierceness, that's where I see folding in a Just Steel or a Stronghold type to try to spice things up. But Forever Young is going to be a big part of my multi-race pick ends, especially liking Ways and Means in the Oaks. So I'll be looking at the old 11-11 double there. And then Anna Marie is definitely my long shot. I know there's some wise guy concerns about what his final price will ultimately be, but based on 30-1 in Vegas after the draw on the 20-1 morning line, I think we'll get the square price. So he's definitely my long shot key.
From DraftKings Sportsbook and DK Horse, Johnny Avello.
Yeah, I'm gonna definitely have a win bet on Forever Young. I know you guys how you feel about the Japanese horse, but I just think this is a different one. And it's solely based on the speed figures coming into this race. I think there's one more move ahead. So I'll be using Forever Young, Catching Freedom on top. This is in my exotics. I'll be using Sierra Leone behind that with Stronghold and Just a Touch. And since I'm doing a podcast with guys who do handicapping for a living, I will be using Honor Marie also. Hey, guys, I'm not stubborn. I am not stubborn. I listen, and, when somebody has an opinion,
that's why we're here.
I'm wide open. So I'll also be using Honor Marie.
What's John Scheinman in Baltimore always say? Be supple about your handicapping. yes, the boss. We'll leave you with the, I've always got the last word because, I'm that way. But Mark Midland is here from Derby Wars and Horse Racing Nation and our founding father, as it were. So what do you say?
I was going to say, it's your show. You always get the last word, don't you? You can edit it in.
Yeah, I'm the showrunner, too. That's what it really comes into play.
So, Anna Marie, I said, Ed and I've been on this horse a long time. I think there's a great, great price coming up the race the right way. And even a 15-1 would be a great price. 20, 25-1 would be fairly amazing. So this is betting-wise. I'm going to use Anna Marie, just to give you an example, in second in the exacta, under Sierra Leone and Catching Freedom, and then and a little bit less so Just a Touch, but I will use him Just a Touch, and then Fierceness, just to not be stubborn. So if Honor Marie runs second to one of those, I want to hit the exacta and hit it well. If Honor Marie runs third to one of those four winners, and then those horses in second, and then also maybe sprinkle in just a tiny bit of Just Steel, Forever Young, just to not be stubborn, and maybe Stronghold in second. So Honor Marie, I'm looking if he can run third, you're going to really nice trifecta, nice exact in second. Sierra Leone will be my top choice. So I'll kind of flip it the other way and use Sierra Leone on top of Catching Freedom, Honor Marie, and some of those other horses. And that's where I probably would sprinkle in a couple longer shots, like a domestic product in third or something like that. But I'm playing against Fierceness and playing for some of the closers, and we'll see what happens. Good luck to everybody.
last, could be least, but I'm going to key Fierceness in exacta and trifecta and superfecta bets, and I will include Sierra Leone, domestic product, Honor Marie, you guys talked me into it, just a touch, and resilience. So we'll see. If somehow we can all get paid off, that'd be great. And by the way, if I can get a no bet down on Forever Young, then that will just stir the cauldron even more. Thank yous again to Johnny Avello, Ed DeRosa, and Mark Midland. If you're listening on the pod, there's a video version of this on YouTube and X, vice versa. If you're watching and you want to do this in the car and drive along and not get in a wreck, you can listen on the pod. And then we're back on Friday. Until then, this is Ron Flatter. I don't know what we are fighting for, but I know that they don't want us here.